a meat bird and running away from the bird cage. It's 1960s. And more recently, another iconic picture of a baby who drowned. Again, the international community tell us that it's due to refugee problem, but the refugees are being created by international law. And this baby drowned on the way crossing the interstate. So the drowning case, the wars between states and global health. And the question is, why is the international community, for example, the WHO, ignoring this? And if you So death and destruction, it's happening more and more. And if you look at the injuries and disabilities, even if you look at the global burden of diseases study, we're basically talking of billions of people who are affected by injuries. Some permanent, some short term, and these are physical injuries, and to add to this, you will have to think of the psychological trauma, the psychological injuries, and the impact on families, and so on. When you come to diseases, again, you find some of the toxins which are being used in wars have long-term environmental effects. So, a good example is what was used in Vietnam to defoliate the jungles. So, because the Viet Cong, the communist Vietnamese guerrillas were hiding in the jungles of South Vietnam as well as within the North Vietnam area. And one strategy was to remove all leaves of the jungles. So we have what they call Agent Orange, which is used. Now, Agent Orange contains dioxin, and dioxin is a well-known toxin. And these are the results. So you use compounds decades ago in war, and or you use it now, and the impact would be in the future. So there is evidence of permanent injuries, and then you have the next generation being affected, tuberculosis. And there is now sufficient evidence of Agent Orange and the dioxin being involved in certain carcinomas. Soft tissue sarcomas, NHL, voice cancer, and CL. And these seem to be going from generation to generation. Displacements, again, we know the story of displacements from international data. The global report on internal displacements shows the amount of refugees that's from one country to the other and internally displaced persons. You're talking of 60 million plus. And these again largely due to conflicts. Largely due to conflicts generated by countries, between countries. Destruction to environment, people who were exposed to the nuclear bomb, or even to the test sites. States. Some of them are still having higher incidence of cancer. I mentioned about Agent Orange. Burning of oil fields during the Middle Eastern wars, such as the Kuwait war, as well as the Iraq and Iran conflicts, there is emission of tons of toxic fumes into the atmosphere. So those affect not only people who are around those areas, they get into the atmosphere and probably affects people in the distant areas. Then I mentioned about dysfunctional states. This map shows what they call a fragility index. You have states can be classified into how fragile they are, how weak they are in their structures, looking at certain political indicators, looking at certain social indicators, and economic indicators. And you see the red areas in Africa, and you see the Middle East, as well as Afghanistan, Pakistan, etc. The countries are supposed to be fragile, and that's where the conflicts are. So you create war in a particular area. 20 years down the road, you accuse those countries that they are having politicians who are corrupt, that the state is fragile. And that again is an indirect long-term effect of wars, and this leads to disruption of the health system. So you have reports, this was a report from the VHA, in 2014, in Syria, 20% of productively to destroy the air. So there is adequate evidence that wars initiated or promoted by more powerful states is a key determinant of mobility and mortality globally. So, and the difference between other determinants is that this is inflicted by humans deliberately against some humans. This is deliberate, this is not weather, this is not climate change. Not illegal, it's an indirect, not necessarily pollution. This is directly your deciding to kill other human beings, can in large numbers. So that's the first part of the presentation. And there's a lot of research on this area. Sri Lanka is behind time on this. And let's take the next question. Why was it ignored? And why was it continue to be ignored? If you speak at any top level WHO or any other UN organization and ask them questions about war, they will not engage. Those institutions will not engage. Because, and in fact, in the run-up to these sustainable development goals, we looked at the literature to see how many times the word war is mentioned. They don't even mention it in their documents. Instead, they all the time talk of human rights and conflicts. So you don't talk of wars between countries, but you talk of violence within countries. And then you tell them you are having conflicts within your countries because of human rights issues and borders. That's the gist of the argument. Why is this so? On top, seated in the chair, that's the UN Security Council, the most powerful institution in the whole world. And it's basically ignoring the rest of us. Because the UN Security Council, the UN system, the Security Council is responsible for discussions on interstate conflicts. They are the people who decide. That's why you would have heard of resolutions against Sri Lanka coming up in the UN Security Council and the government trying its best at different times to avoid it. Because that's where the decisions are made. Now it's interesting to look at who this Security Council is. The Security Council consists of 5 permanent members who came to be at the end of the Second World War. They have veto power. Now all these countries which talk first of democracy have a system where they have veto power. That is not one man, one vote, or one country, one vote. If one country says, if any of these 5 countries says no, that resolution does not go through the Security Council. You cannot go to war against another country. If one of these countries says you can't bring in sanctions, if one of these 5 countries say, and then you have 10 non-permanent members who change every 2 years. Now, you can understand the power these 5 countries have. Now, the interesting thing is, they will not want to drop off, they will want to control over the situation because they are the countries which have the largest military spending. The star ones are countries, so US, China, Russia, UK, and France, who are permanent members, are the people who have the highest military spending. Not only that, they are the largest, they fall into the largest. So it's quite obvious was my response. Then we see, we think of other responses. Prior to the June of 15, sustainable development goals coming in, try our level best to get this into into the sustainable development goals, so that we will also look at interstate goals, different rules of engagement, trying to resolve issues between countries without going to war, limitation of small arms being exported. And remember, Canada, Sweden, who come and reach to us, and even Norway, they are the biggest producers of small arms. So if you are thinking of reducing this the ongoing propensity to war, we have to think of the determinants. We have to look at methods of reducing arms being circulated in the global areas. Then we came up with a Hikkadu declaration to coincide with the Chol. Again, didn't attract much attention. We tried with the global petition. Again, before the Sustainable Development Goals came in, and these points were also brought up at the Commonwealth Medical Association. But I think individuals can't do this. We have to think as a country, as a nation, whether we can contribute to this discourse, whether we can take it. And that's why I think I chose this topic here, because I think KU is ideally placed. If we are going to have a Sri Lankan response, we have to have a knowledge base to achieve global peace. We have to be able to say, these are the determinants of war, these are the factors which we need war, this is how we handle. And also Sri Lanka should take a lead in advocating for global peace. I'll briefly go through these areas. When you talk of a knowledge base, there's a fascinating amount of literature on this, even for mathematicians, physicists, etc. In fact, the mathematical modeling of wars is a fascinating area, because if you really look at how wars are propagated, you'll be able to find out, you'll be able to determine the factors which initiate, the factors which make it progress. I'm just going to focus on mathematical modeling, of course, which is very interested in modeling these things. So, field, as it was started by way back by a person called Richardson, the mathematician. And he simply collected the number of deaths per conflict. And he came up with this graph from 1820 to 1945. So on your left, the lesser the number of people dying, you say one or two dying, there would be a large number of conflicts. There are only a few people dying. But as you go down, you see more and more, when numbers of people who are dying, number of coral death, he used the term corals, conflicts, for wars, then on the horizontal axis. And as the number increases, the number of conflicts causing a large number of death also increases. This is called a power distribution. Something which is different to the sort of distribution that is used to normal distribution. And interestingly, wars can progress initially, only a few die, over a period of time, the same conflict can escalate. Now, this was in 1948. Do not mind in nature. They oxygenators, and when wars are being fought, scientists have a big role. Now, the second part, so that's one area of generating knowledge for peaceful purposes. Second is advocating for global peace in the international arena. Sri Lanka can play a role. And though we have the inferiority complex that we are small, remember we are not very small, we have our population is bigger than many countries in Europe. Our surface area is bigger than many countries like Luxembourg, Belgium, Ireland, etc. And I think we can do it. And we have done it before. Even now the Japanese respect Sri Lanka because the finance minister at that stage, Jayasinghe, immediately after the war, spoke of words of peace so that Japan would have a way of building on its after its destruction. You saw the first pictures of Hiroshima, the first slide is Hiroshima, and now you know when you go to Japan, how Japan has transformed. And one key element was the fact that the international community agreed to give aid and allow Japan to develop. And a person who spoke for peace at that stage was Jayasinghe. So we have done it before. So my final take is this. Impact of interstate wars on health is devastation, catastrophe. And it's probably ignored in sustainable development goals, etc., because of the undemocratic processes which are within the UN system. The more we recognize it, the easier it is to really change those. Finally, Sri Lanka